Some days back, I was asked a question by a man that I cannot accept things as they are in life. If something is this way, I want it that way. If something is going my way, maybe I want it better. If something is not going, I want it to go my way or the highway. I cannot accept people for who they are. I always want them to change or to modify themselves according to me or my wishes, my goals, my desires, my aspirations. I cannot accept things that come of its own accord. I cannot do that. So, can you please tell me how to do that? Well, today we will try to discuss, in short, hopefully, about how to accept things, and we will also discuss why we cannot accept things as they are. Alright, because acceptance in life is a symptom of something else. Well, what that is, we will discuss. So, if you know the root cause, then you know from where the problem is coming. Otherwise, we will just read some stuff in the internet, you know, motivational quotes, let life be the way it is, you know, accept things, accept people. No, it doesn't work like that. If it was so easy, everybody would have accepted things as they are. So we have to identify the problem where the root cause is, alright? And we will also discuss from the scriptures about certain personalities by trying to take examples from their exemplary lifestyles, alright? And hopefully we get an understanding of how to... the road is there, you see. I need to accept that there's a lot of noise in the room. Alright, and yes, like every day, if you are new to the channel and if you have not yet subscribed, then please subscribe somewhere below. And if you want a consultation from me regarding any area of your life, or if you want some acceptance in your life, you could always go down to the description section of this video, where you will find the link to my website to book a reading personally with me, okay? And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you must find Him. Otherwise, you cannot accept things as they are. Okay, so what is acceptance basically? Acceptance means at a higher level. At a lower level, you can say, you know, being happy with what you have in life. You know, that's at a lower level. But at a higher level, acceptance means accepting the will of God, agreeing to the will of God. Because we have to understand the fundamental principle of law of karma. What is that? Law of karma is very simple. It says, what you do to others happens to you. If you do good, then good things happen to you. If you do bad, then bad things will happen to you. Now, many people will argue here that, oh, I have never done anything wrong to anybody in this life. Yes, there are many people who claim like this. And the only thing that I have seen in my life is bad, 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 bad. Only bad things have happened in my life. Okay, so when we are talking of karma, we have to understand we are not talking from the perspective of this life. Because unless we do something wrong to somebody, nobody can actually do wrong to us, alright? So, let's understand that fundamental principle. So, anything apparently which is not so good according to our definition of good and bad, if that is happening to us, then we have to understand and we have to acknowledge this fact that it is we only who would have done something to somebody else. Otherwise, that doesn't come to us. So, acceptance at a higher level means accepting the law of karma, which means accepting what God has given us, what God has ordained for us. But the question is, why we cannot accept things? Why? Because the main reason is we are not in sattva-guna. Because acceptance is a symptom of sattva-guna, mode of goodness. If you are not in sattva-guna, you cannot accept things. You will want to change things and you will want to change people. How many of you have seen or heard, raise your hands or write in the comments, talking, or have you seen others talking, you know, oh, my husband doesn't listen to me, my wife doesn't listen to me, my son doesn't listen to me, my daughter doesn't listen to me, my mother doesn't listen to me, my father doesn't listen to me. Everybody should listen to you, right? Everybody should accept you, but you do not accept anybody. Yes, should I repeat? Everybody should accept you, but you do not accept anybody. That's the precarious situation of the modern society today in this Kali Yuga. Because you cannot accept things in life as they are if you are in Rajoguna or you are in Tamoguna. Rajoguna means always you want change, you know. Oh, this is like this, you know, I will change it. This is like that. No, no, I don't like this. I will change it, you know. Now, this does not mean in any way that we do not do things which are good for us. So, if something is not good for us, which means something is taking us away from our spiritual identity, which means, for example, if suppose there's a friend of yours, maybe your best of your best of your best friend who is indulging in drinking, and that person calls you and says, hey, you know, wanna meet, you know, purani dosti, our old friendship, you know, we will rekindle that love which we had, you know, so-called love. So will you not come? And then if you say that, no, I don't want change, let me accept things as they are, you know, God has sent him to me, so that's nonsense. You must deny that person, otherwise that person will end up ruining your life, because he is an addict and he or she will also make you an addict. So don't make that foolish decision by saying, you know, I'll just accept things in life. But at a broader spectrum, when we talk of acceptance, we mean to say that how to accept the so-called negative things or bad things that happen to us in our life. All right, apparently those things which are injustices according to us, apparently. So see, let's go to the Mahabharata and check. Let's make two groups now, you know. In one group, we will put those people who could accept things. And in the other group, we will put those people who could never accept things. And in the group of the people who could accept things, let's put these two personalities. They are not two actually, they are one, but they are still two. For example, Yudhishthir Maharaj and Vidura, because they are both Yamaraj himself. So in a way they are one, but still they are two. So if you see the story of the Mahabharata, Vidur, he was the son of the Vyasdev and another maid servant. Alright, so Vyasdev and Dasi had united, and because of that he could not become the prince, or he was not qualified to become a king, because his mother was not a queen. And on the other hand, Pandu and Dhritarashtra were sons of Vyasdev and Ambika and Ambalika. Okay, and Ambika and Ambalika, they were the queens. So that is why these two were qualified to sit in the throne. Now, Vidur could have said, "What nonsense is this? You know, this is injustice. Just because my mother is not a queen, I will not be allowed to sit in the throne. No, I will sit in the throne. This is bloody injustice. I will not let this happen." Vidur could have said like this, but he didn't. He was given the post of the prime minister because he was extraordinarily knowledgeable. He's one of the 12 Mahajans actually, because Yamaraj is one of the 12 Mahajans and he is Yamaraj. All right. Swayambhu Narada Shambhu Kumaro Kapilo Manu Prahlado Janako Bhishmo Balirvaya Sakhi Vayam. Yamaraj himself tells this to the Yamadutas. My God, the God of death is telling this shloka. Please listen it carefully. It is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Okay, go and find this shloka. This describes the 12 Mahajans. And therefore, Vidur did not protest unnecessarily. He accepted the norm of the society that time. Now, this does not mean that you should accept anything and everything that happens, but he knew that, okay, I am somewhere else. And not that he didn't have anything. He was the prime minister. That was also a very respectable post. Now, his brother Dhritarashtra could not accept this. There you go. Now, by his destiny, by his karma, by his own karma, not by anybody else's karma, by his own karma, because of some of his misdeeds in the previous lives, about which I will discuss some other time. He did not have eyes. He was blind, both internally and externally also. And because of that, Vidur said that he is not qualified to sit in the throne, which is true, because a king has to have his body in the best possible form so that he can guide people, he can lead people, he can take care of others. So Dhritarashtra did not have eyes, but that did not mean that he was completely useless. He could have been the best brother to Pandu, he could have been the best advisor, he could have been the best, as in Hindi they say, na, right hand. I mean, in movies or some places they say like this. Which means that he could have been the best aide of Pandu, he could have assisted Pandu always. But no, he did not do that. He could not accept this fact that by my karma, I do not have eyes. And because of that, I cannot sit in the throne. And always he used to harbor envy in his heart against Pandu, because then Pandu became the emperor and he became the representative later on when Pandu departed from this world. And the same gene from his body went down to his great son, you know, Duryodhan. Now, according to the rule, the son of the king would become the next king. So if Pandu was the king, then his son Yudhishthir, who was the eldest, would become the king. Rule number two, in that generation, who is the eldest would become the king. So in that generation also, Yudhishthir was born before Duryodhana, so Yudhishthir would qualify to be the king. Rule number three, and the most important, who was the most deserving candidate? It is unanimously Yudhishthir Maharaj. There is no doubt on this. So from all the three angles, Yudhishthir Maharaj was the one who would qualify unanimously. There is no second opinion on this. But Duryodhan and his brothers, including his uncle Mama Shakuni and their friends, of course, they could not accept this fact. You see, why? Because they were in Tamoguna, they were in Rajoguna, alright? And on the other hand, Pandavas, just see their lives. When they were very small, you know, their father left. Yes, Pandu died when Pandavas were very young. But there is no instance in the Mahabharata where Yudhishthir Maharaj or Kunti or the Pandavas like Arjuna, they ever say that life is so unjust, life is so unfair, you know, this is not good, this is not the way it should be, you know, our father is not there, what nonsense is this? So many things, you know, Bhima was poisoned by Duryodhana when he was a child, that time, you know, can you imagine? A small boy poisoning somebody else, that was how vicious Duryodhana was. But Bhima never complains, you know, oh, you know, life is so unfair, I was poisoned when I was young. No, he never does that. And that's the greatness of the Pandavas, that they never ever harbor envy or hate in their heart. Never ever. There's no instance when they do this. And that is why Lord Krishna was literally their servant. Yes, 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 yes. You heard it right. They were also Krishna's servants. But Lord Krishna was also their servant. That is why Lord Krishna would love them so much. And they say that Arjuna was like Lord Krishna's breath, you know. Breath and you. Always together. That is because they were so virtuous. And therefore, they would always obtain Lord Krishna's blessings and Lord Krishna's mercy. But Duryodhana and his company, Duryodhana and company, Duryodhan, Shakuni, all of these people. Now let's take the example of Duryodhan's mother, Gandhari. Gandhari heard that there is a proposal for me for marriage with Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is blind. So what she did? She accepted that. What did she do? She took a cloth and she tied it in her highs. Can you imagine? What a great level of sacrifice that is. That is unimaginable. Nobody is there in the entire history in Satyuga, Dwaparyuga, Trita Yuga who has shown that level of commitment and surrender to the husband. Nobody ever. It is only one, and that is Gandhari. Nobody else. But her own brother Shakuni could not accept this. Shakuni said, oh, this is injustice, you know. Why will my sister go and marry somebody who is blind? This is nonsense. I will not accept this. And what did he do? He always harbored envy in his heart towards the Pandavas, towards Pandu and Kunti and Madri, and that led to the destruction of the entire dynasty. All the Kurus were slaughtered. There you see what happens. So now coming back to the principle that why we can't accept things, because we are in Rajoguna, we are in Tamoguna, because Rajoguna means enjoyer, proprietor and controller. Alright, he is not behaving the way I want, change him. She is not behaving the way I want, change her. That's Rajoguna. So the solution is you have to come to Sattvaguna, unless, without that we cannot accept things as they are. Now acceptance does not mean that we just keep sitting and doing nothing, alright. That doesn't mean that, that's not the definition of acceptance. We should always try to improve our life. At the same time, we have to understand that the wrong things that happen to us, yes, those are the things, to a large extent, they are beyond our control. So in case of Dhritarashtra, you know, he did not have eyes. So, what can you do ultimately? Of course, nowadays, you know, you can do some surgery or something like that. But at a broader spectrum, you have to understand. Now, I'm not saying that you should not get eyes, or if you are having some physical disability, do not treat that. I am not saying that. But at a level of a principle, you have to understand that, which Dhritarashtra could not understand. So, the first thing is we have to arrange our life in a way that we can do those activities which are in the mode of goodness, okay? They will elevate our consciousness. And by that, we will realize that we can also accept things in life. Alright, so what are those activities? Those activities are, we should get up early in the morning, spend not much time sleeping in the morning hours, okay, preferably at 5 or before that. And we should abstain, and in the morning we should read the scriptures, we should listen to mantras, stotrams. These are the things we should do. And as soon as you get up, you should take a bath, preferably in cold water unless you have health problems. And then you can go to office, do your job, whatever it is. Eat sattvic food, which includes, you know, vegetarian food, which is abstinence from meat, fish and eggs. Yes, all the three. And then not to indulge in you know, watching things like, you know, pornography in the internet or anything related to adult material, which makes us more and more animalistic, which degrades our consciousness, which takes us to tamoguna. Yes. And not unnecessarily wasting our time and our lives in gossiping about who is having an affair with whom, discussing about the private parts of the opposite sex. Yes. Who got the promotion? How? You know, for God's sake, let that person enjoy the promotion. Why are you so concerned? Yes. You focus on how you can get a promotion. Do not try to denigrate somebody who has got some promotion. That is his karma. That is her destiny. They have got it by their own karma. Okay. So, that's what is important. And at the end, the most important thing is we have to read the lives of these great personalities. Like Vidur, for example. Yes, Bhishma Pitama, my God. Another great example. Well, I will not speak about him. It's already 20 minutes. So, if I speak on him, this video will keep going on for eternity. Yes. So, when we know the characters, the lives of these great personalities like Prithu Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, so many great personalities, Yudhishthir Maharaj, Ambarish Maharaj from the Srimad Bhagavatam. Yes, Maharaj Nimi, what does he talk when he meets the nine Yogendras, the Nava Yogendras? Do you know? If you know, then write it in the comments. Alright. So that's a beautiful conversation which the Nava Yogendras and Maharaj Nimi has in this. They have in the Srimad Bhagavatam. You can read it. You will be amazed. You will be mind boggled. Alright, so when we come to Sattva Guna, then we will naturally be able to accept things in life and not be so much focused on changing things and situations. Because always remember, things are beyond your control after a certain extent, okay? And this in any way does not enforce the fact that we should improve our lives. That definitely we should do. And that's the thrust of the video, that we have to increase the Sattva Guna in the body, in our life, in the mind, body, mind and soul. Then naturally the side benefit of that is we can accept things, and ultimately we will realize this shloka that Lord Krishna says in the Gita, na bhoktaram yagya tapasyam sarva loka maheshwaram suridam sarva bhutanam gyatva mam shantim ruchati. One who understands that I am the enjoyer, controller and proprietor of everything, he is at peace. That's known as the peace formula. Okay, so until next time, wish you good luck. I hope you can accept things in life, or at least you can try from today to do things which are in Sattva Guna, especially in the morning, and by that you will definitely be able to see a great transformation in your life. And I am very happy to see the messages which people have sent me after the Akshaya Tritiya. I had told them that start reading the Srimad Bhagavatam, and they have started and their lives have changed even just within such a short span of time. Wow, it's amazing. Alright, so if you have not started reading, then start reading the Srimad Bhagavatam. Otherwise, maybe you will also end up mailing me one day that I am not able to accept things in life. Okay, there you go. Until next time, if you are new, then please subscribe to it. To my channel. And if you want a consultation from me, then you could go down to my website, which you will find in the description section below. God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. Namaste.